HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Small Mercies, a novel by Dennis Lehane. Performed by Robin Miles. For Chisa. To cut oneself entirely from one's kind is impossible. To live in a desert, one must be a saint. Joseph Conrad, Under Western Eyes. Historical note. On June 21st, 1974, U.S. District Court Judge W. Arthur Garrity, Jr. ruled in Morgan v. Hennigan that the Boston School Committee had systematically disadvantaged black schoolchildren in the public school system. The only remedy, the judge concluded, was to begin busing students between predominantly white and predominantly black neighborhoods to desegregate the city's public high schools. The school in the neighborhood with the largest African American population was Roxbury High School. The school in the neighborhood with the largest white population was South Boston High School. It was decided that these two schools would switch a significant portion of their student bodies. This order was to take effect at the beginning of the school year on September 12, 1974. Students and parents had less than 90 days from the date of the ruling to prepare. It was very hot in Boston that summer, and it seldom rained. 1. The power goes out sometime before dawn, and everyone at Commonwealth wakes to swelter. In the Fennessy apartment, the window fans have quit in mid-rotation, and the fridge is pimpled with sweat. Mary Pat sticks her head in on Jules, finds her daughter on top of her sheets, eyes clenched, mouth half open, huffing thin breaths into a damp pillow. Mary Pat moves on down the hall into the kitchen and lights her first cigarette of the day. She stares out the window over the sink and can smell the heat rising off the brick in the window casing. She realizes she can't make coffee only when she tries to make it. She'd brew some on the stovetop. The oven runs on gas. But the gas company grew sick of excuses and killed their service last week. To get the family out of arrears, Mary Pat has picked up two shifts at the shoe warehouse where she has her second job, but she still has three more shifts and a trip to the billing office before she can boil water or roast a chicken again. She carries the trash can into the living room and sweeps the beer cans into it, empties the ashtrays from the coffee table and the side table, and one she found on top of the TV. It's there she catches her reflection in the tube and sees a creature she can't reconcile with the image she's clung to in her mind, an image that bears little resemblance to the sweaty lump of matted hair and droopy chin dressed in a tank top and shorts. Even in the flat gray of the picture tube, she can make out the blue veins in her outer thighs, which somehow don't seem possible. Not yet. Not yet. She's only 42, which, okay, when she was 12, seemed like 1 foot over the threshold into God's waiting room, but now living it is an age that makes her feel no different than she always has. She's 12, she's 21, she's 33. She's all the ages at the same time. But she isn't aging, not in her heart, not in her mind's eye. She's peering at her face in the TV, wiping at the damp strands of hair on her forehead, when the doorbell rings. After a series of home invasions 2 years back in the summer of 72, the housing authority sprang for peepholes in the doors. Mary Pat looks through hers now to see Brian Shea in the mint-green corridor, his arms full of sticks. Like most of the people who work for Marty Butler, Brian dresses neater than a deacon. No long hair or bandit mustaches for the Butler crew. No mutton chop sideburns or flared pants or elevated shoes. Definitely no paisley or tie-dye. Brian Shea dresses like someone from a decade earlier, white t-shirt under a navy blue barracuda. The barracuda jacket, navy blue, tan, or occasionally brown, is a staple of butler crew guys. They wear it even on days like today, when the mercury approaches 80 at 9 a.m. They swap it out in the winter for top coats or leather car coats with thick wool lining, but come spring, they all bring the barracudas back out of the closet on the same day. Brian's cheeks are shaved close, his blonde hair cut tight in a crew cut, and he wears off-white chinos and scuffed black ankle boots with zippers on the sides. Brian has eyes the color of Windex. They sparkle and glint at her with an air of mild presumption, like he knows the things she thinks she keeps hidden. And those things amuse him. "Mary Pat," he says, "how are you?" She can picture her hair, splayed, sodden on her head like congealed spaghetti, can feel every splotch on her skin. "Power's out, Brian. How are you?" "Marty's working on the power," he says. "He's made some calls." She glances at the thin slats of wood in his arms. "Help you with those?"
"That'd be great."
He turns them in his arms and stands the pile upright beside her door.
"They're for the signs."
She seems to remember spilling beer on her tank top last night and wonders if the scent of stale Miller High Life is being picked up by Brian Shea.
"What signs?" "For the rally. Tim G will be by with them shortly."
She places the slats in the umbrella bucket just inside her door. They share a space with the lone umbrella with the broken rib.
"The rally's happening?" "Friday. We're taking it right to City Hall Plaza. Making some noise, Mary Pat, just like we promised. We're gonna need the whole neighborhood."
"Of course," she says. "I'll be there." He hands her a stack of leaflets.
"We're asking folks to pass these out before noon today. You know, before it gets crazy hot."
He uses the side of his hand to wipe at sweat trickling down his smooth cheek.
"Though it might be too late for that."
She takes the leaflets, glances at the top one.
"Boston's under siege. Join all concerned parents and proud members of the South Boston community for a march to end judicial dictatorship on Friday, August 30th at City Hall Plaza. 12 noon sharp. No busing, never. Resist. Boycott." "We're asking everyone to cover specific blocks. We'd like you to cover..."
Brian reaches into his barracuda, comes back with a list, runs his finger down it.
"Ah, like you to cover Mercer between 8th and Dorchester Street and telegraph to the park. And then, yeah, all the houses ring in the park."
"That's a lot of doors."
"It's for the cause, Mary Pat."
Anytime the butler crew comes around with their hands out, what they're really offering is protection. But they never exactly call it that. They wrap it in a noble motive. The IRA, the starving children in wherever the fuck, families of veterans. Some of the money might even end up there. But the anti-busing cause so far, anyway, seems totally legit. It seems like the cause, if for no other reason than they haven't asked for a dime from the residents of Commonwealth. Just legwork.
"Happy to help," Mary Pat tells Brian. "Just busting your balls."
Brian gives that a tired eye roll. "Everyone busts balls in this place. Time I'm done, I'll be a eunuch." He tips an imaginary cap to her before heading down the green corridor.
"Good to see you, Mary Pat. Hope your power comes back soon."
"Wait a sec," she calls. "Brian." He looks back at her. "What happens after the protest? What happens if, I don't know, nothing changes?" He holds out his hands.
"I guess we see."
"Why don't you just fucking shoot the judge?" she thinks. "You're the goddamn butler crew. We pay protection to you. Protect us now. Protect our kids. Make this stop." But what she says is, "Thanks, Brian. Say hi to Donna.
Will do.
Another tip of the imaginary cap. Say hi to Kenny. His smooth face freezes for a second as he probably recalls the latest neighborhood gossip. He flashes her doe eyes.
I meant.
She bails him out with a simple, I will. He gives her a tight smile and walks off. She closes the door and turns back into the apartment to see her daughter sitting at the kitchen table, smoking one of her cigarettes. Fucking power's off, Jules says.
Or good morning, Mary Pat says. Good morning works.
Good morning. Jules shoots her a smile that manages to be bright as the sun and cold as the moon. I'm going to need a shower, Ma.
So shower.
It'll be cold. It's fucking 90 degrees out. Mary Pat pulls her pack of Slims back across the table from her daughter's elbow. Jules rolls her eyes, takes a drag, directs the smoke at the ceiling in a long, steady exhale.
What did he want?
Brian?
Yeah.
How do you know Brian Shea? Mary Pat lights her second of the day.
Ma, Jules says, her eyes bulging. I don't know Brian Shea. I know Brian Shea because everyone in the neighborhood knows Brian Shea. What did he want?
There's gonna be a match, Mary Pat says. A rally. Friday.
Won't change anything.
Her daughter tries for a tone of casual apathy. But Mary Pat sees the fear swimming in her eyes, darkening the pouches underneath. Always such a pretty girl, Jules. Always such a pretty girl. And now clearly aging, at 17, from any number of things. Growing up in Commonwealth, not the kind of place that produces beauty queens and fashion models, no matter how pretty they were coming out of the gate. Losing a brother, watching her stepfather walk out the door, just when she'd finally started to believe he'd stick around. Being forced, by federal edict, to enter a new school her senior year in a foreign neighborhood not known for letting white kids walk around after sundown. Not to mention just being 17 and getting into who knows what with her knucklehead friends. A lot of pot around these days, Mary Pat knows. And acid. Booze, of course, in Southie. Most kids came out of the womb clutching a Schlitz and a pack of Luckies. And, of course, the scourge. That nasty brown powder and its fucking needles that turn healthy kids into corpses or soon-to-be corpses in under a year. If Jules keeps it to the booze and the cigarettes with the occasional joint thrown in, she'll only lose her looks. And everyone loses their looks in the projects. But God forbid if she moves on to the scourge. Mary Pat will die another death. Jules, she's come to realize over the last couple of years, never should have been raised here. Mary Pat, one look at her baby pictures and childhood snapshots, all scrunched face and wide shoulders and small, powerful body, ready to audition for the roller derby or some shit, looks like she came off a conveyor belt for tough Irish broads. Most people would sooner pick a fight with a stray dog with a taste for flesh than fuck with a Southie chick who grew up in the PJs. But that's Mary Pat. Jules is tall and sinewy, with long, smooth hair the color of an apple. Every inch of her is soft and feminine and waiting on a broken heart the way miners wait on black lung. She just knows it's coming. She's fragile, this product of Mary Pat's womb. Fragile in the eyes, fragile in her flesh, fragile in her soul. All the tough talk, the cigarettes, the ability to swear like a sailor and spit like a longshoreman can't fully disguise that. Mary Pat's mother, Louise Wheezy Flanagan, a Hall of Fame Irish tough broad, who'd stood 4'11 and weighed 95 pounds soaking wet after a Thanksgiving dinner, told Mary Pat a few times, you're either a fighter or a runner. And runners always run out of road.
Mary Pat sometimes wishes she'd found a way to get them out of Commonwealth before Jules finds out which she is.
So where's this rally taking place? Jules asks.
We're going downtown.
Yeah?
That gets a wry smile from her daughter as she stubs out her cigarette.
Crossing the bridge and shit.
Jules raises her eyebrows up and down.
Look at you.
Mary Pat reaches across the table and pats her hand so she'll look at her.
We're going to City Hall. They can't ignore us, Jules. They're gonna see us. They're gonna fucking hear us. You kids ain't alone.
Jules gives her a smile that's hopeful and broken at the same time.
Yeah?
She lowers her head. Her voice is a wet whisper when she says,
thanks, Ma.
Of course.
Mary Pat feels something clench in the back of her throat.
You bet, sweetie.
This may have been the longest she sat with her daughter, just talking, in months. She'd forgotten how much she likes it. A tiny clap of thunder shakes the floor beneath their feet, rattles through the walls, and the lights come on above the stove. The fans start moving in the windows. Radios and TVs in the other apartments return to battle with one another. Someone whoops.
Jules shrieks, I call shower,
and bolts from her chair like she owes it money. Mary Pat makes coffee, takes it into the living room with one of the freshly emptied ashtrays, and turns on the TV. They're all over the news. South Boston and the coming school year.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.